We've got the benefit of having everybody who wants to come and share good information with us, and I had to reschedule one or two other people because we would have had four presentations if we had that possibility this meeting, which is a really great opportunity. We could be here for hours. You have to bring your dinner with you. But tonight we have two really special folks here, and one of them is a return who's going to give us an update on what happened since he was here last when you heard about the Grand Canal mini reefs and the things he was proposing. And I want you to know we have to keep a very tight schedule because these guys are so popular, they're headed to another place for a 6 o'clock. So we got to get them off the key and on the road, and they will go through the things they want to share with you so they can get to the next place. So first up is Phil Chiocho, who was here before with us about the Grand Canal. So come on up and let us know what's happened. And do you want this microphone over there?
I put the presentation has not been vetted for accuracy because I'm just a concerned citizen, and I'll make up stuff the whole way we go through, but you'll get the idea by the time we're done. And so imagine this room is the Grand Canal, and this is about how deep the canal was in 1925 when they built it. So we're in the canal. It's a little bit narrower most places, but this is the room, and this is the canal. The door is the outlet at Roberts Bay, and of course it's half closed off because there's a shoal that keeps the water from flowing in and out. So we're not getting much flow right now. And the air vents provide our oxygen. So there's our air coming in, but in the canal, since there's not much flow, the water doesn't get a lot of oxygen, especially at the bottom. The chairs are your dock. So you're sitting at the dock on the canal and your legs are hanging over the dock, but they don't provide the benefits that mangrove trees to provide filtration and shelter. When Archibald built the canal, he just built it and put in the sea walls, but he could have built it with a living shoreline, with mangrove, with a healthier kind of environment. So the birds that used to live there, that ended up in women's hats apparently, didn't get the benefit of the canal, and therefore you don't see too many birds. There's no places, a lot of areas for them to even perch. And there's no flow. Since 1925, the sediment has been filling the canal with jello-like mud, holding nutrients, hydrogen sulfide, and leading to an anoxic state, which means a no oxygen state. So can you turn the lights down? So this is what the canal looks like, because it has all the sediment. And I just had Lorraine turn the lights down just so we could feel like we're sitting on the dock in the bay, and the water has the sediment sitting in it. And what I'd like to do is figure out a way, as a concerned citizen with others, how we could turn the 9 miles of the Grand Canal into something that could be as internationally famous as the beach right across the street. So the Grand Canal, oh, look who's here for the seafood festival. It's Andy and Opie have shown up, and of course, everybody has a mythology about their lifestyles, and Opie's so excited to go fishing and see all the birds, and here he comes. He's hoping he can catch some fish and some crabs and take them to the seafood festival. Be a happy young kid, because the studies from Harvard and others say if it's a happy young kid and they're happy in their teenage years, they're going to be happy for the rest of their life. And no one likes more to see birds and fish and have a fun youth than Opie. But remember, Andy says, I told you the Grand Canal has had a health issue ever since it was started in 1925. And besides that, where we go fishing in North Carolina, it wasn't North Carolina. It was a couple miles north of Studio City, and it was a 3-acre lake dug by a guy for his cattle. So the illusion and the myth and keeps going on and on. But he's hoping that the environmental, but it's not what the environmental government fixes. Bad water, don't they fix stuff? And we always think, yes, of course, that's what they spend their whole day doing. I've asked some friends to go ask the Department of Environmental Protection for help. Let's make the Grand Canal into something we can really have some fun. Wait a minute, stop, don't throw that rock. Why not? The baby stone crabs will love living under rock. Well, obviously he's taken fifth grade ecology classes and he knows. Too late, rocks are habitat. In the rock goes. The rock is, it could be riprap. It could be any kind of piece of limestone, which is what we're sitting on here, pointer rocks being pointed in case. And he goes, infilling of rock or anything into the water is against the law in Sarasota. Opie, you really messed up here. He says, I don't understand. He says, well, that is the law in Sarasota. You can't take riprap or any kind of rock and put it into a body of water. The laws are written to keep the water exactly the way it is. So when Archibald built the thing, there was no rules, there was no permitting, there was nothing in the way to go and dig it. But then they came up with the rules and they locked it down, apparently. Maybe somebody can tell me how they happened. I haven't figured it out. But we want to remove the shoal. Here's what we would like to do as citizens. Remove the shoal, increase the dissolved oxygen, improve the flow, and add fishery habitats. It seems like a nice thing to do. We feel it could be a productive nursery for the Sarasota Bay watershed. Pretty obvious fifth grade science. What did your friends learn who you asked to go down with the environmental people to check? Well, it's not what I expected, Andy says in his little drawl. Here's a friend. Okay, we'll go and find out when the Sarasota County Environmental Protection Division will dredge the shoal, improve the dissolved oxygen, increase the flow, and add habitat to the canal. This should be easy and would produce thousands of new fish, crabs for the community every year forever. I know, I can't believe we have to go ask. Just stay calm and they will say, wow, great idea. So George goes up to the counter at the Environmental Protection Division and says, there is a shoal at the entrance to the Grand Canal and we want you to dredge it so the water will flow better for the health of the fish. The Grand Canal is not a public waterway. What does that mean? No dredging for you. The Grand Canal is 10 feet from where the shoal starts out towards Roberts Bay is a public waterway. Where the shoal starts, 9 miles in, is not. So when we asked them for their maintenance dredging permission, and we asked about the West Coast Inland Navigation District funding, and one other group that they went and asked and talked to, the executive director says, no. It's not a public waterway. So I sent them a nice little letter, which I haven't heard back from because they probably got upset with me. I said, well, in that case, the Grand Canal was dug on private land with no permits, and so it should be under the auspices of the Siesta Key Association. You guys can make up your own mind what you want to do with it. It's not public. I checked with Duncan Docks, Todd Wagner, and I said, well, how much would it cost us to do? He says, well, you gotta get the permit. First they come out, an engineer has to come and measure it. So you get a tape measure and you go from here to here to there to there. I can figure that out pretty good. And then you gotta say, what kind of sand is down there? I said, well, how much is that? He said, about $7,000. I go, okay, but he doesn't guarantee you'll get the permit. So I said, well, what if we get the permit? How much to take a backhoe and whatever and dig out a couple scoops? He says about 25,000. I says, it's not gonna happen. And he says, well, that's what it would cost. So Elaine says, the fish need aeration and more dissolved oxygen. They can't breathe. No aeration, dissolved oxygen for you. It's as if they had never heard of aeration in a saltwater environment. They, freshwater ponds, you see them, but in the saltwater, their only retort to me was, who's gonna pay for the electricity? And I didn't want to tell them that there are solar aerators now available. There's lots of things that are continuing to do. So it just ended right there. Kramer comes up and he says, the Grand Canal needs to have better flushing and flow. No flushing for you. Get out. Now, the Grand Canal once had some flushing when it was connected to the Gulf of Mexico, but that ended up getting filled in. Maybe something like Midnight Pass, how it got filled in. And I said to them, I says, well, what about, since everything is artificial, the bay's artificial, the canals are artificial, ever since they dug the intracoastal waterway, everything is artificial. What if we put some kind of, say, an Olympic-sized swimming pool filter at the old water treatment plant? As the tide comes in and out, and in and out, and in and out, it just takes out the sediments and adds oxygen to the water. You take it from the bottom, throw it out the top, and cheap, just get a pool company to put it together. Couldn't figure that one out. That's not in the books. They can only do what's in the code. So if there's not in a code, they can't make a decision. Makes it tough. So Jerry says, we want habitat added for the juvenile fish and crabs to grow, and more places for the oysters to filter the nutrients. Not allowed. No infilling structure for you, which means we can't add riprap along the base of the seawalls to act as a breakwater, and we can't add any kind of underdock mini reefs. It's not in the code. We don't know how to do it. I'm not going to give you permission. We're not allowed to think about it, because if we think about it, we might get fired and lose our pension. So we're not going to do that. And glad we could help get out. So Andy says it did not go well. But we could add habitat in the city of Sarasota, part of Siesta Key, as a test site. The city of Sarasota does not have the restrictions. City of Sarasota is saying, yeah, bring it on. We need more fish. We need more crabs. Let's figure something out. And in a moment, I'm going to introduce Sandy Gilbert from START, and he'll give you an update of what the city's doing. Manatee County is saying, yo, let's do it. So they're installing these, and I showed you a picture of the one at the Mar Vista restaurant with all the mangrove snappers swimming around. After just a month or two, they started coming in there. But if we were to take this as a demonstration, and we got a few, put a few on here, put a few right in here, a dead end lagoon here, we've got some of the elements that will be representative of the Grand Canal. And for the same cost of going down to Best Buy and getting a few OLED TV sets, we can maybe get a bunch of these things and stick them in there. There's a grant, there's some way to find some money for it. Well then, Opie says, well then let's start with Bay Island as a demonstration. And if it's a demonstration that works, Siesta Key looks real good to the world. Mm-hmm. I told you, put down the rock. No infilling into the waters of Sarasota. The kid just doesn't get it. We tell the kids, you can't do it. And as sheriff, put your hands behind your back. You have the right to remain silent. And now Opie's going to go to jail. It's going to cost us $23,000 a year, plus about $8,000 for his health. Plus he's going to be learning everything in jail college. He's going to be an unhappy kid for the rest of his life. And Andy's just doing his job, even though it's not in his jurisdiction. You know how sheriffs do. So it's a sad ending to my research on the Grand Canal, unless we as citizens want to do something. Thank you. I'd like to introduce Sandy Gilbert from START, Solutions to Avoid Red Tide. He will tell you factual things. Yes, sir.
Was the soup dot seed Howard Burnout or Dave Pierce?
Whoa! DB seems to be a person I met. And another one, Joe something. And you could ask Joe Volpe, he joined me, so that would be, he'd be more accurate than me.
On a serious note, could you take, somebody happened to have a boat, could you put the anchor out and kind of run and blow that shoulder?
That's called proc dredging?
Yeah.
I'm gonna get Andy to get you out of here and have you arrested, because I asked the same question. I said, me and the boys can go up there. And I said, why don't we just change the navigation sign? The end of the channel is here. Rev it up, bud. And you could just prop dredge that thing in about a day with six boats, it would probably do it. It's been there forever. And it's probably from people going out. I'm tired of going so slow. And it plows it up. Well, you could go 5 feet coming in, blow it out to the bay, blow it out. It's 10 feet on this side, 3.5 here, and 10 feet over here.
Exactly,
blow it out. I said, Howard, I'm gonna get the boys and we're gonna do some prop dredging. And Howard said in his very authoritative voice, do not do that. So if it happens, I'm not gonna be part of it. But I would
you'll be arrested. I was on the Longboat Key Commission Board of Zoning, and it came up and people did it. They were caught, they were fined, and I think one of them was arrested.
Okay, oh, yeah, that's a simple way to do it. That's how, back in the day, we do it. Yes, sir.
It is from problems. Would removing the shoal allow more sediment to make its way in?
There's a thermocline in the water column, and below the thermocline is a separation of healthy water and the bad water. So by removing the shoal, which is a blockage, would allow the bottom to move. Now, the Grand Canal is not known for its flow. And in the study in 1974, they put some floats at the entrance during the tide shift. And they went up as far as the edge of Palm Island, but not up the dead end canals. And then they came back. So the top of the water flowed, the bottom did not. So I started thinking, well, it's all fake anyhow. Why don't we just put a couple of sand filters in here, get a pool company to make it as part of their routine each week, and start adding oxygen, pulling the sediment, back flushing it into a little swale at that property there where the wastewater treatment was, let it evaporate, let it oxidize, and maybe within a few months, we'd have ourselves a much cleaner.
Even a pump on the bottom, push it out, the tide would come in on the top.
All that. Things could happen, but it's illegal. So you might want to catch the police and just hop in their car and go to jail college.
We can grab some shelves and do it at night.
Sandy Gilbert.
Hi, folks. As Phil said, I'm Sandy Gilbert. I'm the chairman and CEO of START. That stands for Solutions to Avoid Red Tide. Our mission is to work to clean the excess nutrients in our waterways that feed algal blooms of all kinds, particularly harmful ones like green algae and red tide. We do that in three ways. One, we work with policymakers, most of the time more favorable than the story Phil's been telling, and try to get them to fund things that would take nutrients out of the waterway. We were very active in talking to the county about the Bee Ridge plant, for example, and that's going to make a big difference in this bay. We do in-water projects, primarily with bivalves, oysters, and clams. These are natural things that filter the water. By the end of next year, our work with Sarasota Baywatch will have 1 million seeded clams in Sarasota Bay, just north of the Ringling Bridge. Each clam will filter 20 to 30 gallons of seawater a day. They don't die in red tide. And we do oysters in Manatee County, very similar situation. There we collect shell from restaurants that you eat, and instead of going into the landfill as garbage, we put them into the waterway and they make new oysters. And these shell that are live, we call them, or fresh from restaurants, produce 23% more new oysters than the ones they dig up out east. So that's what we do. And the third thing that we do is we have kind of what I'm doing tonight. We do public outreach. I would encourage you to contact us about our Red Tide and You presentation I've been showing all over the world. It's been very popular. It tells you what is red tide, why do we get it so bad here, and there's some reasons. What's being done about it? Probably more than you think. What is START doing about it? And most important to you, what can you as an individual citizen, just one person, do to affect the nutrients that cause and make red tide grow? So that's what we do. And one of the other in-water projects we do is the mini reefs that Phil mentioned. And I know you're interested in those, so I'll talk about those. They're made by Ocean Habitats. They are, Phil will hold up a picture. I didn't have a visual. This is what it looks like sitting on your dock. It's 24 inches by 36 inches by 24 inches deep. It goes under your dock. You do not see it. It only floats 3 inches above the water, so your neighbor across the canal isn't going to be calling you and saying, that's unsightly, I don't like it. And that's the size of them. They have 4 shelves, and what you're in essence doing is creating a hotel for sea life. You have in your canal, most of which will die, probably 90%. One of the reasons it's kind of cloudy, you have a lot of larvae, algae, things floating through your canal, but they don't light well. They don't land on your seawall. It's too slick. They really can't live. They can't live. A few oysters will, but they can't live on your dock pilings. But you put this hotel in there, and Phil will now show you what they look like in this place, Mar Vista, in just 3 months. The entire rack is filled. It has coral on it. It has sponges on it, all kinds of life, and look at the fish that it has attracted. That's why people like them, because they like to see the fish. We like them because they filter, when they're full, about 30,000 gallons of seawater every day is being filtered by the life on that reef. And so they're really quite effective. And what you're doing is simulating mangrove roots from mangroves. What are you simulating? You're creating a place to hide, a place to light. You're creating food, particularly for the fish that visit. And you're raising young things that can hide in there that can't hide on a seawall. So you're restoring the habitat. You're taking better advantage of the habitat that's there. You're not putting anything in the water. It's just attracting it, that it's already there. They're very durable. They're made out of polypropylene. It's the same material that's been approved and used for boat bumpers around pilings. You see those white donuts? That's what it's made out of. It's not the plastic that deteriorates and gets into the water as those so-called nurdles. It doesn't deteriorate. And how do we know? Because they've been, most of them that have been put in, there are 3,000 in the state right now. Most of them have been put in, have been in for 10 years or more. Some have been in for 15, and there are about a dozen of them that have been in for 25 years. So if this plastic, as people like to call it, it isn't, but if plastic, were deteriorating, what would happen? The original animals that landed on the farm would slip off because they don't have anything to hold on to. So would all the other animals, because they're glued on top of the other animals. None of them have collapsed. None of them except one has ever been knocked down in a hurricane. And the only reason that one broke away was because the dock collapsed. So they've lasted a long time. They're durable. They're not a lot of work to you. You should look under your dock once a month and be sure they're just floating like they do. You might see a line that holds them, maybe doubled over. You just undo it. If it looks like something you can't fix, you simply call Ocean Habitats, and they come in and they'll take care of it for you for a small fee. You're probably asking then, what do they cost? Currently, if you were to buy them right now before the end of the year, and there is a price change at the end of the year, if you bought it retail, not through me, because we're a nonprofit, it's $235 per unit plus 7% tax. That gets you to $250. $50 installation for $300. If you buy them with a Start 10 nonprofit discount, you get them for $250 with no tax, and the because we're helping sell these for ocean habitats, you get a $50 tax deductible that they later pay to us because you bought a mini reef through us. So they are available. The city of Sarasota is about ready to order about 20 of them. We've been working with them. As I said, there are already another 20 up at Anna Maria, up at Mar Vista Restaurant, and we're talking to another number of other cities about buying them, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. I'm sure you have some. Please.
How many are currently in Siesta Key? Any at all?
Not really, no.
Okay.
No.
Yeah. Some in Sarasota now.
Yeah, yeah. Some in Sarasota, some in Manatee County. A lot of interest in them, and as more people begin to buy them, more people will, you know, be familiar with them. But the only ones you can really see in any number right now is to go to the Mar Vista Restaurant on Longboat Key, okay, walk out to the end of the dock, look down, and you'll see them. And it's really quite amazing. You saw the picture of how they've grown, and it was that picture was taken 3 months after they were put in the water.
Bring your mask and snorkel because it's a great show. You can just sit there and watch all these mangrove snappers swimming around.
Anyone else? Yes.
Our association has a fairly sizable dock. You're not allowed to keep a boat there, but you can come and pick someone up.
Right.
And it's in the intercoastal. Mm-hmm. Are these suitable for that?
Well, that's why we picked the Mar Vista site. That's basically in the northern part of Sarasota Bay, a lot of weather coming right up the intercoastal, a lot of action. That's, of course, why it's filled with sea life. But the point is, yes, these things are designed to take some pretty good action. They're held by some holding ropes with floats that go around your pier under your dock. So they go like this, and they go like that, but only a certain amount. And again, they weather storms really well. They've only lost the one because the dock collapsed.
It's similar to throwing a bait bucket off your dock.
Right.
It just floats. Doesn't touch the bottom.
Right. So I have brochures here if you want. Yes, someone else? Please.
Sandy, have you worked at all with the Sarasota County?
Yes, Howard's name has come up. Howard and I are discussing the issues. He would love the DEP to give a statewide waiver, and they don't want to do it. Not because they object to them, it's just a headache. Really, legally, these are like your boat on your dock. Your dock has to be permitted, but your boat does not, because it floats and it doesn't touch the bottom. As a bait bucket, it floats and it doesn't touch the bottom. But Howard's name's been mentioned. He's pretty well known for being more of a door closer than an opener. I'm working with him as best I can. Right now, we're just doing them in the city and hoping, frankly, to convince him. But he was very disappointed that the DEP would not say, we're going to just waive for everyone, everywhere, anywhere in the state of Florida. They didn't want to go that far. Now, notice, there are 3,000 of them in the water. Not one has been pulled out. The DEP said, never said to me, Sandy, where are those units? I want to pull them out. But they just sit on their hands and don't give Howard what he wants. Now, Longboat Key and Manatee County, we don't care. We like them, they make sense, and we're gonna use them. So it's pretty much up to the governments. But I have an agreement with Howard that until I can move him in some directions, I won't personally sell any in Sarasota County. And I'm hoping as the city, as another municipality buys them, more pressure. People are called, by the way, the other thing, if you live in the county and you want one of these, call him and tell him you want one, because he's getting tired of those calls, and it may actually help move him. Yes, sir?
Do you have an estimate of the economic benefit of these?
That's tough. The real benefit is the biological, the sea life you brought that you've kept in there, the water clarity. Your dock will be clearer around it for 12 to 15 feet radius. There have been some measurements of the oxygen levels have gone up 20 or 30%, but it's so site specific. And in fact, it's not even site specific, it's tide specific on a given day and the wind, and everything changes. And so things come and go by the dock, so it may be clearer one day than the next. So the answer is, our result that we're talking is biological and the sea life. Is it reducing nutrients? Yes, but very, very tough to measure.
Just a quick follow-up. May we meet after the meeting to talk about how Rotary Clubs in this area could help?
Sure, I'd love to.
But today's article in the Sarasota Herald said the sheep's head are coming in and they like juvenile crabs. Each of these reefs does 3,000 juvenile crabs a year, which if you start to multiply 3,000 crabs, 3,000 juvenile fish, not just the forage fish, but your juvenile snook and that sort, then all of a sudden your fishermen are starting to get an economic boom out of this, and the marinas are getting an economic boom, and the tourism is coming on. I'm going to do a submersible, semi-submersible submarine viewing show, going up and down, have some fun.
We're also going to be very big at the new Bay Park. You've probably heard about that. START is funding a first ever stormwater nutrient barrier to keep the stormwater from the site from running directly into the bay without it being taking some of the nutrients out. We'll be putting clams and oysters in the lagoon and the mini reefs. Bill Waddell really loves them. We're going to put some of those in. So once that takes, again, more people will be aware of them and what they can do. But I'll be happy to talk to you after. Yes, sir.
Have you spoke with Senator Gruters in our area to ask NOAA to just sign?
I've spoken with Senator Gruters. I know him, work with him. He's working on, how can I describe, a much bigger project, and one tends to limit the amount of things you ask people like Senator Gruters to do. So we will be meeting with the DEP on the impact and importance of the nutrient barrier for stormwater, and we're trying to apply it. We know it works on reclaimed water. It's already been done. We know it will work on septic effluent. Could be very interesting to you people. Putting a trench between septic systems and the waterway, and we expect 60% or more of the nutrients being out. This is a big idea, and I probably, when I see the head of the DEP with Joe Gruters next month, I probably am not going to mention the mini reefs because it's relatively a smaller deal. He hasn't even heard about it from the levels way down below him. I know that. He doesn't even know what they are. But my real goal with him is to get the state working with, let's start requiring these towns to filter stormwater. So my experience with political people, pick one thing, mark it up, tell them how we're going to save economically, and then leave the office. You're not going to get two things. Now, I don't think it's a Joe Gruters thing. I think it's other people's thing.
The other thing, too, is Dr. Panaro would probably be up. She is big in these things. You know, she was creating these years ago. At Moat, her endorsement would go along.
Moat is using these. Yeah. Moat's also making their own. Yeah. But Moat is doing them. They put a lot of them in Boca Grande as a test. They did pretty well. You know, this is an independent thing, and we're trying to raise money as a nonprofit. So I'm not on that working with Moat. Someone had a question. Yes, ma'am.
Those of us who live on the north end of Siesta are in the city.
Yes, you are.
Now, it would be really a pretty neat Siesta Key test case if we get them in our little section, which is City of Sarasota. And we're on Bio Louise, other people are on Hanson's Bayou. And those are right in our area. If we can get some under the docks, and then Siesta Key Association could say, look, these are some of our members, too, that just happen to live across the line into...
Right. We're working with Bird Key. They're interested. They have a man that's already offered to start a stipend of money. He'll throw in. He has two. He can't believe the results. He's had manatees under his dock. He says, we've never had manatees in here. And he's thrilled, and he's trying to sell his group. But that's the kind of thing we'd love to do.
If you would speak at our Bay Island Siesta Association meeting sometime.
I'll leave you my card. You contact me. We'll do that.
Our party is Monday night. Come and talk to us.
Okay, I don't know if I can do Monday, but I certainly can do sometime. Someone else, or are we all done, folks? I'll be here. The one gentleman had some questions. Anyone else? I'll sit. We'll go outside. Oh, I'm sorry, I missed you.
Can we do something? Can you give Howard a call? You mentioned that. Perhaps maybe just tickling a little bit about the fact that we're interested in this. Is there some action we can take?
I think the real issue is for us to get them in the city group first, and particularly with the city government. Right. So once I tell him Tom Barwin likes them, he goes, oh. It's water torture. We're going to just wear them down till. And I finally looked at him and I said, Howard, frankly, I've talked to a lot of people, and you really don't have any authority over this. But since the county gives us some money, Dunkin' Docs can tell them that, and they have. I'll buy them, I'm going to use them, see ya. But I have a relationship with all the commissioners, so I work with them, not pointing fingers. And so if I can deal with Howard, I will. At some point, I'm not the most patient person. I'll finally say, Howard, let's you and I go to the commission. You state your case, and I'll put holes in it, and we'll get it done. So, to your question, let's get your folks up the north end to do it and the city to do it, and I think then you can make a bigger case. Hey, it's working here. What's the problem?
That's great.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, that was great. What else can we make you put a visual up for us about? I mean, that's pretty clever. It really takes all the anger away, doesn't it? I love it.
I'm an anger management.
I mean, it's excellent, excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Okay, we have also people from the county. About, I think this time last month, everybody was getting worried because those large blue containers were dropped off along the streets, and some of them were actually in the streets, and people started putting their recyclables in, and actually they weren't supposed to start until January 6th, if I'm not mistaken. But nobody was rolling out the information, and it had a tag in a sealed bag, kind of like a furniture tag, but I think everybody's, oh, here, let's throw it in. So we got them to pull them back, and had nice neighbors who went around and pulled all of their things in for them. So we have someone from the county here who's going to tell us about the new recyclables and the things, and she's brought goodies for people. We always like that when people want to share free stuff, right?
I don't think it's a goodie.
And well, it's good to have stuff. That's what I say. So welcome, and I think what you're Wendy, because I think we also thought Allison might come as well.